Good evening, buenas tardes. Welcome to our study session for September 26th. We will get started with roll call. Director Decker.
I am here.
Director Barros.
Here.
Director Stroll.
Here.
And Director Smith will not be joining us tonight, but I am here, so we do have quorum. And I will now turn this over to Dr. Snell to lead us through our meeting.
Thank you, Director Zavala Ortega, and all the other directors able to join us this evening, and people tuning in live and potentially watching the video recording as well. We're glad that you're able to join us here on this last meeting that we have in September. And this is a study session, which means the board typically goes a little deeper with topics. And we're very excited today because even though we haven't formally adopted a strategic plan, we're starting to do some work that's related to the strategic plan and some goals with that. And this is our first progress monitoring check. And so today we'll talk to you about a couple of the goals, some of the action steps that we are doing associated with those goals, and some of the progress that we've made to date. Our presenters tonight welcome any questions or comments. Some of the questions we may respond to right now, and other questions might be, that's a great question. Let's think about a good way to respond to you and to the public with that information. So with that, I'll share my screen and just do a short introduction and then introduce our first speakers this evening. So, as I mentioned, we are a draft strategic plan. October 10th is when the board will have this on the agenda for their approval. And I know you, as directors, have seen a lot of this over the last 15 months and given a lot of direction and listened to a lot of input from the community. Really, our plan with using study sessions moving forward is to frame the work that we report to you through the four really main themes from our strategic plan. The first is a vision of a graduate. And I'll elaborate on these a little bit more in a couple of slides that follow. And then student-centered experience, student-centered staff, and student-centered community. And you as a board helped us identify some aspirational overarching goals, and then there's some supporting goals within that. And then those goals are driving work plans. And we're really looking at utilizing a continuous improvement cycle where we're doing some planning. We're doing some things, we're studying those things, and then we're act upon what we're seeing happen as a result. So continuous cycle through this. I want to just walk you through some slides that you're pretty familiar with at this point, but these are the attributes of a vision of a graduate as defined by our community, and a vision of a graduate statement. These are the three student-centered priorities and the aspirational goals. And tonight we're going to focus in on student-centered staff. And just want to take the time to read this aspirational goal that we want to advance each student on their journey towards our vision of a VPS graduate, previous slide, through a diverse and skilled workforce that reflects our student population. We want to develop a culture of belonging by honoring the unique gifts of each student in an inclusive and inspiring learning community, with both physical and emotional safety. So there's a lot to that, right? Lots of steps to make that happen. And so two of the supporting goals of that aspirational goal are related to student-centered staff. The first one that we'll hear tonight is presented by Kirsten Copeland and Christy Lindholm, two administrators here at Central Office. And then the second one tonight will be presented by Jeff Fish and Victor Cato, two administrators from our human resources team. And with that, I think I'm going to turn it over to Christy and Kirsten to walk you through the goal and what's been going on since that, since our start of the year.
Fabulous. Thanks, Dr. Snell, and good evening, directors. It feels like a long time since I've gotten to work with you in this way, so I'm excited to be here. And I'm really grateful to get to work on this piece of our strategic plan working on how we impact our students' experience in school through the adults that serve them. Adult learning is a big passion of mine. So when Dr. Snell said, this one's yours, I was like, yes, let me have it. So Kirsten is right alongside me as we do this. I'm in charge of this plan, but there are really a lot of hands that are working on it together. So many of our directors are involved in most of the work plans because they're the ones that have got the closest connection to schools and are making the work happen. So I'm going to start and sort of frame the big picture of our work. Then Kirsten's going to narrow down a bit and talk specifically about our investment and reorganization in our instructional coaching and instructional specialist or TOSA team. So we'll be with you for a few minutes. So Jeff, if you wouldn't mind getting to the next one, I won't read the goal again. We're looking at our five-year vision partly as a way to really highlight the fact that we are a PLC district. That's what we're working for, to have us function from every level of the system as a PLC. And with that, using our guiding coalitions to drive the work. So our goal right now, and it's in draft form because I'm the first one to present to you. So a lot of this feels a little drafty because we've gotten to get our teeth into it, but I don't know that we're totally finalized. But so we want our guiding coalitions both at the district. So we have a big district team that is full of educators and administrators working together. And then each school has a guiding coalition. So we want those groups to use the student experience and student performance data to guide decision-making around professional learning for our staff. So taking into account all that we're getting back from the field, both from students and from our educators, to say, well, what's up next? What's just in time? What's important for people to learn and know so that kids have a better experience? There's a lot of goals. We're also involved in de-implementation and trying to really narrow down. So this is a little tricky as we work on goals and what's most salient, but we do have a number of goals that all dovetail. So the first big one, and this is really where Kirsten's bailiwick is just-in-time job-embedded professional learning opportunities for staff. So just-in-time, meaning it's exactly what people need when they need it, and job embedded, meaning that they get to do it with their colleagues, they get to do it in relationship to their own students in real time. We're not having outside experts come in and teach us. We're really grappling with what we need to know on our own and getting better with each other. Next one is stabilizing our learning environment. Nationally and in our district, we're hearing about how tough it is for kids and what behavior is telling us. We're learning a lot about that. So both in classrooms and on school buses, because that's a place where we're understanding that kids are getting really upregulated before they even get to us. Stabilize that learning environment to increase a sense of belonging, emotional safety, and systems to allow for deeper student learning while offering our staff ways to develop a thriving classroom community that decreases disruptive student behaviors. The next one is something we've been working on and our timing hasn't quite gelled. We're hoping this is a year. We have a lot more structures and tools in place to get this off the ground, which is the guaranteed and viable curriculum, which is knowing exactly what all learners will learn at every grade level. What are the benchmarks for that learning and how we're going to assess that so that teachers have actionable data and action plans for adjusting their instruction. There's another page of goals. A big piece of work that Kirsten is also leading is helping our professional learning department and all of our systems use nationally recognized standards of professional learning. So no more winging it. We really want to be targeted. We want to be in line with what research shows is best practice for adult learning. So we're working with Learning Forward to do that. And this is another piece of the guiding coalition. Want that group to really interface tightly with professional learning and the advisory groups that we have. We really launched advisory groups last year. I talked to you about that a lot from the one I was involved in. But most of our directors also have them. So Kirsten has one for professional learning. Chris Giannotti and Brian Graham have one for curriculum and instruction. Lucy Estrada Guzman has one for dual language. So that's a system that we're really utilizing to get feedback. And then our biggest one is overarching is to strengthen our tier one instructional practices to positively impact the learning of all students. We know that it is not successful to try to intervene if you don't have a strong core in place. So we're really working on the strength of our core. Next one. Oh, wow. Suddenly there's animation. Sorry about that. And this is our why. Because everything our adults learn, practice, refine, impacts student learning. And when our adults are not learning, when they don't feel like they're getting what they need, then students aren't getting what they need either. So that's our pinpoint focus. And these are the measurable outcomes. And this is kind of a work in progress. Some of the things that we're looking to have a little bit more qualitative feel. So we're trying to figure out, like, how are we going to measure all of this? We know we want student outcomes on national norms, normed assessments to improve, but there's also a lot more to it in terms of how our people experience us as a system, how kids feel belonging, how teachers feel belonging, how the system communicates with one another. So these are our initial thoughts around how we measure. One thing is we want to understand and decrease both number and the disparity of student referrals. And I'm talking specifically about behavior referrals that come from classrooms, common spaces, and on buses. And we are working on an initiative, I guess you'd call it, called Champs and Stoic from Safe and Civil Schools. It's basically how you set up your classroom environment and the kind of reflective work you do as a practitioner to understand how the community you set up and the expectations you clearly set up for kids, how that works for them and whether or not kids are able to connect to their environment in positive ways. So this is something that is a K-8 district-wide rollout, and 9 through 12 also has pieces of it, looks a little bit different. But we're offering this training to all educators anytime throughout the year, and we offered it last year. And what we've done sort of to measure our progress around this is to make a note of who took the training already last year and how their discipline referral data compares to people who haven't been trained so that we can see what the impact of that initiative is. Tracy, do you have a question?
Yeah, you mentioned, I think you said all educators have access to this training. Is that general ed teachers, special ed teachers, like counselors?
Mm-hmm. Like, yes.
Kind of across the board. Is that certificated and classified, or just kind of?
I think right now it's just certificated. Have classified begun yet, Kirsten? I know we're talking about how to get bus drivers into the mix.
Specific schools are using the CHAMPS trainings that they're provided, specifically the associate principals, to begin working with paras. But that's occurring right now just at the site level. We do have a plan for onboarding paras beginning this spring with some learning opportunities.
Thank you.
And is that, because on a slide or two before, when you talked about kind of stabilizing the learning environment, that one caught my eye because I was like, "Ooh, that's a big kind of task." And so is this kind of one of the main tools towards achieving that goal? Or I would be curious if there
it
are
is.
Other. Okay.
It is. This is making sure that all classrooms are set up with really clear expectations and kids know what's expected of them at any given time, that there's a common language and processes and systems across a school building, ideally from school to school in a feeder pattern, so that as kids go through our system, they understand what they need to do, they know what the language looks like, they know what it means. I personally have seen this have tremendous impact on a school community. So we're investing really heavily in it. Our teachers have told us really loud and clear that they need more tools to understand and work with student behavior.
If you have any more information, I would just love to dig into it more.
We have books for you.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely kind of in my wheelhouse of I haven't heard of it, so I'm kind of, my interest is very piqued, and so I would be curious to learn more about it, and also as you guys go through, just what the data shows to you. So
yeah, excellent. Kyle?
Yes. So you said you were looking at data for those classrooms for the teachers that participated last year in the training. I'm curious, what was there any qualitative data, initial feedback from the educators that participated?
About the training itself?
Mm-hmm.
The qualitative data would be, we had four initial introductory sessions in May. One thing that we observed after the first session, that each subsequent session had more participants than the last session. So the word was traveling via teachers, which was great. The additional feedback from session participants has been right around that just-in-time piece, that quotes like, finally, really glad that this is taking place. This has been wonderful, have really been the feedback that we're receiving. I think teachers are feeling supported in this because they still retain that autonomy, but then we have common structures that we're now developing. And that is the hope and goal, is that it translates into our students receiving that same experience, that there's clarity of expectations, which creates safety for those students in that predictability. And so, yes, the qualitative measures are coming in. As it relates to the quantitative measures, we're simply right now just observing. We've had 444 staff member or certificated staff members participate in this training, with another 144 set to go during our professional learning day in October. And we just right now want to observe, are we noticing any differences in trends from those who have participated and those who have not, and send out some type of survey, I would assume, in the spring, just to gauge teacher feedback related to the training and the impacts that they believe that the work has had on their classroom environments.
Thank you. And when you all join us for classroom walkthroughs on the 9th, I think it's the 9th, we'll be using the Stoic framework for our note takers. So you'll have a chance to see kind of what it is we're looking for and what we're teaching teachers to think about as they reflect on their practice.
Thank you. And I think the impact on students, of course, is the ultimate goal. It just seems like sometimes these programs take longer to impact at the student level, but I was grateful to hear the initial educator feedback.
We started this work last year with the effective classroom plan, and just to get the whole district thinking around, hey, we need to be looking at our systems and get really granular about what we're teaching kids that we expect and setting up our rooms. So I think we started that last year in the summertime. This is the next iteration of, okay, now we're doing this. We'll keep adding. And I expect actually that we'll start to see impact for students this year. So, all right, the next measurable outcome is around the WIDA, which is the English language assessment that our multilingual students take in the late spring or early spring, actually. And this is a newer test for us. This will be year 3. So we are working with teachers to really better understand the load, the rigor that this test has for our English language learners, and helping teachers understand what's required of every teacher in every classroom for our multilingual learners. You'll see that we want our exit rate to go up. It's not a lot of increase, but it amounts to 25 more students. We know that because we're changing the way that we work with multilingual learners, and that we're expecting all teachers to gain the skills to work with them effectively, to gain academic English, that we're expecting that our success rate on exiting students out of the program by fifth grade is going to be pretty slow. But that's what we're working on. We have some schools, for example, are having their teachers take the WIDA as an assessment for themselves, just to understand what actually a kid has to know in first grade or second grade, what the language demand is. What we know about our kids right now from our last WIDA test is that they're excellent listeners, but they also need to read and speak and write. And so we need to help them catch up on those areas, and our teachers need to gain more confidence in providing that kind of instruction. So we're working on making that shift, supporting teachers to feel better about that. The next one again is around guiding coalitions and some of the things that we think we'll see from focusing our work on PLCs and guiding coalitions. There's certainly an exit survey that indicates that guiding coalitions are having positive impact on teachers' lives and for their professional learning. We're going to complete the essential standards work. This is the GVC, the Guaranteed and Viable Curriculum work I was speaking about. Every team should have their norms, their mission, and their vision created via the guiding coalition, so that they're very focused on what their work is and what their roles are. We believe that this will all trickle down to students in how Panorama data shows up, and we expect to see an increase in student belonging. We also expect to be able to measure increased performance in iReady. We're also, Jeff may talk about this later, we're working with a new company, Upbeat, to survey staff around their satisfaction about working here in order to both retain and recruit people to our district. So we're looking for staff voice and input beyond what Panorama was able to give us and really dig deeply to understand what our staff's needs are. There's one more page, Jeff. We're looking at how we want to see the impacts and outcomes for working on universal design for learning. We've talked about it a lot. Now we're going to work on engagement this year. We want to see how is that going to impact kids and how are we going to measure it? So some of these shifts we want to see, this is the part we want to see, is like, how are we actually going to measure whether or not that shift is happening? But the work that we're after this year is to optimize individual choice and autonomy for students as they learn, to allow students to participate in the design of what they do in the classroom, both activities and tasks, to optimize relevance, value, and authentic learning for them, and to minimize threats and distractions. So hopefully you're seeing kind of a thread of what we're after. We're hoping this is becoming more and more coherent, both for our educators and for our public. And then this last one is our investment and restructuring of our instructional coaching team and program. We want to increase our number of educators participating in coaching cycles to at least 80%. While we are not saying, we're walking a fine line between saying you have to do it and we really want you to do it. It's valuable for everybody. We're all learners. We want you all to engage. This is probably the number one way we believe you'll grow in your practice. So looking for at least an 80% participation rate. And then again, we want to see increased performance on iReady, on SBA, on interim assessments that buildings are creating. I think there might be one more slide. And then this is just some ideas for our progress monitoring, which is not yet due, but we wanted to show you all the things that we've already been doing for professional learning. And Kristen will talk about an aspect of it, but one of the biggest things that the team pulled off already this year was the communities of practice for teachers of their pre-duty days. And it was phenomenal. It was super well attended, and all the departments at the central office helped prepare it. All of our TOSAs were involved in creating curriculum for that and teaching their peers, which was wildly successful. So these are all the different pieces, all the ongoing parts that we're already working on. I hope that there's not a lot more to come, because this is a lot and we really want to use this to stay focused and integrated on what we're doing. Any questions before I hand off to Kirsten to talk to you more about instructional coaching and our district specialists?
No questions, but those are lofty goals, and I'm excited just to see how you guys progress through this and the outcomes. I'm excited I think these are great.
Thank you. Me too.
One quick question. After the pre-duty days, what's the mechanism for collecting feedback for educators?
That's a great question. At the end of any professional development course that's provided, where clock hours are collected, we have a course evaluation that aligns with our learning outcomes. And so we collect feedback throughout the year related to PD. That's both in the buildings and then I guess, centrally created and provided. So we're collecting feedback from our workforce throughout the year. This year, we'll be partnering with Learning Focused to do a standards assessment inventory based on the learning experiences of certificated teachers in the district. That will be, teachers will have the opportunity to take that on October 13th during the final professional learning day of, state-funded professional learning day of the year. And we'll have a chance to collect some additional feedback related to the learning experiences. But yes, we're regularly collecting data throughout the year on their
There's also a lot of communication up and down the system from guiding coalitions to instructional coaches to leaders and then back and forth to the district. And we're adjusting to that as we hear, we're soliciting a lot of feedback, and the more we ask, the more we get. So it's super helpful. All right, Kirsten.
All right. And so as part of that, learning experience, I just wanted to kind of stick with our theme around universal design for learning, that expert learners are experts in learning. And so whether you are a student or staff member in our system, our goal is that you remain purposeful, motivated, goal-oriented. And so we are rolling that out in a thoughtful manner. This year, our community of practice theme focused on the theme of reimagine. It was PD content that was created by teachers, for teachers, based on their interest. We had just under 1,200 certificated staff members attend over the two-day period, offering 45 courses for elementary and just under 40 for secondary, with a total of 234 sessions in that time. There was a 94% approval rating from our session participants, with 90% of our participants strongly agreeing or agreeing that the event met all of our district learning outcomes. I've also included some direct quotes from the session feedback from a few of our participants related to their experience over those 2 days. And we'll continue to provide learning opportunities that are focused on the use of inclusive trauma-informed practices, specifically through the implementation of the STOIC framework and CHAMPS. And then, as Christy had touched on, it's a tiered approach for K-8 and then 9 through 12. Where staff will continue their development of high leverage practices. And we're gonna do that specifically this year and moving forward through job embedded professional learning experiences. And so again, kind of sticking with our theme, when teachers stop learning, so do students. It's a famous quote from an instructional coaching pioneer, Jim Knight. And so there are four specific areas that I'm going to walk you through that touch on how this restructure occurred and the why behind it. The scope of the work and role clarity, and then what we call the flow, our feeder pattern assignments and what that structure looks like. And then learning outcomes and any questions and a chance to ask any questions that you may have. Okay, so what we heard and how we got here. We were hearing from both our teachers on special assignments and our building principals tension around the previous structure, where it was kind of a spray and pray method, where TOSAs were assigned to buildings and they were connecting and doing coaching cycles or checking in with individual teachers. And we were seeing a low yield in terms of our return on investment. Principals were feeling detached from the number of folks that were coming in and out of the building with their own specific goals that maybe their departments had, and were asking for more alignment in terms of the work. And then our classroom teachers as well were feeling frustrated, quite frankly, with connecting with multiple individuals who each wanted to support, well-intentioned, but it just wasn't clear. And so we wanted to move to a consistent model for coaching and support, reducing the number of individuals who each building had to maintain contact with, and shift to a job-embedded model. And then we recognized that secondary buildings, if this is what we truly believed in, were also going to need job-embedded support. And the outcome of this was increased achievement for our students and our teachers, and then creating inclusive and equitable places through increased use of inclusive and equitable practices. And so it really boiled down to this problem as directors. We sat and chomped and chewed on this. How do we provide a high quality and consistent job embedded learning experience for our certificated staff members? And the solution that we reached was creating a student-centered inclusive model of development using a building-based instructional coach. And so with our department partners in the equity department, as well as our technology department, we were able to move some FTE around to provide embedded coaching support to our middle school and high school sites this year, which was new for them. So we now have instructional coaches at all levels. And really, it's about moving toward a proactive model for teaching that's responsive by building consistency across our tier one, increasing class time for our students, and then increasing the desire for ongoing learning and growth for adults with adults or staff members, colleagues they have relationships with, and then providing job-embedded professional development, professional learning experiences. And the research is pretty strong that that is the best way to improve instructional practice. And so our alignment to this vision is still in alignment with the plan. And as Jeff had mentioned or read early on, we are still focused on creating graduates who are academically prepared, culturally competent, critical thinkers, effective communicators, resilient, lifelong learners, and engaged community members. And so I'm not going to read this because I know you guys have seen this numerous times, but there is alignment with both our student-centered experience and our student-centered staff goals. Jeff, if you can move to the next slide. The experience goal, specifically, we wanted to develop and sustain a culture of belonging, safety, and positive student and staff relationships, as well as continuing to prepare each student for the opportunities and demands of the next step on their vision of a VPS graduate. And so this is the alignment with that student-centered staff. So I just want to get into the supporting goal on the next slide. So some of our outcomes specifically are developing rich, relevant, and meaningful professional learning, aligning our practices with our district's mission and goals, and always keeping at the forefront that learning is our fundamental purpose within our organization. So again, this is just highlighting some alignment to our district priorities around student-centered experience and student-centered staff. And we wanted to model what we want our coaches to take back. So I actually conducted a survey for their voice and input in terms of what their hopes where as we were setting a course in this work collectively. And so here's some of the themes. The coaches wanted to build relationships and trust with teachers. They wanted to promote student learning and achievement and create a positive and supportive school culture. What they identified for themselves as collectively as opportunities of growth areas, they wanted to continue to grow in their understanding and application of UDL, becoming more data literate in the use of data and assessments and how that works within systems of support, supporting equitable learning spaces for our students, and they just wanted to become better coaches. And so instructional coaching was an area that they identified for continued growth. And so I surveyed how they prefer to learn. Our goal this year, my goal for them this year, is that they feel the difference in their learning experiences. And we're doing that by modeling universally designed learning and access. Our coaches identified that they were visual learners, kinesthetic learners, they learn by doing, hands-on activities, role-playing at time. They wanted to collaborate. They asked for time to collaborate with each other specifically. And so we're supporting that. And then opportunities to reflect and apply what they've learned or they experienced in their interaction with their colleagues in the building. And so we intend to support them by providing those opportunities to collaborate. Each Tuesday, they have a chance to meet for a variety of learning experiences, but those experiences are consistent and they are driven by what they need and what they want. And so really providing that just-in-time support. And then we've really worked to provide clear expectations throughout the pre-K-12 system in terms of the coach's role and the expectations for how they are to support and what supports they need. And then not to overwhelm them because they are a powerful fulcrum within our buildings and our system. So we're streamlining the communication and giving them plenty of opportunities to hear what their principals are hearing, have a chance to ask clarification, and then align with both the building and district's messaging. And so with that clarity came the definition of roles. Coaches had an understanding of what they were tasked to do, but with this realignment, we wanted to make sure that the other members of their team, instructional specialist and instructional facilitator, TOSAs, were also clear. And so role clarity is really the degree to which employees have a clear understanding of their task, responsibilities, and processes at work. But we wanted to make sure they were also clear about the roles of the people around them and supporting. And so we spent some time doing some alignment. And so I'm going to share with you how our what we refer to as district administrative units are dispersed throughout the system and kind of just a high level overview of their different roles within the system. So we'll start with our instructional specialists who are district based. So that means they work out of JPC and they support primarily our categorical programs, but some other programs, and they are on a regular teacher contract. And so they have direct support with building specialists. So think of LAP or potentially even title funded specialists who are working in the building, but they are district based. Our next group are our instructional facilitators. Our instructional facilitators are our district instructional facilitators are our teachers on special assignment. So they come back a little bit earlier, usually the beginning of August. And they are direct supports to directors as well as instructional coaches in the building. These TOSAs tend to specialize in specific content areas or departments. They work in teams that vary in areas. And one of the goals of the directors was, or one of our visions was that they would begin working in cross-functional teams. So each bringing strengths and knowledge from their backgrounds and departments, and working together to create comprehensive learning experiences and support opportunities for our instructional coaches. And then our final unit is our instructional coaches. These are now within all levels, K through 12, and they are building based, and their job is to provide instructional support for teachers. They are supervised by professional learning, but they are under the day-to-day direction and guidance of our building principals, and they're also evaluated by those same building principals. The focus of their work is really to engage in coaching cycles, co-planning, consulting with teachers, and then supporting inclusive practices and providing district and building directed professional development opportunities, and they are building based. And then finally, our instructional directors who oversee facilitators and specialists and support our instructional coaches. So along with that clarity, we looked at the organizational structure and we aligned them by feeder. And so we could keep equity at the forefront, we have our feeders kind of grouped as houses this year. And those houses have names that are associated with the dispositions that can be found in the dignity framework. And so Janelle Ephraim's house would be empathy, that's aligned with her feeder pattern. And then we have listening, which is Christy Lindholm's, openness, Bill Omen's, and then patience, which is Jim Gray. Those just translate into empathy and listening, our elementary feeders, our houses, and then openness would be our middle school pattern. And then we have patience for our high school pattern. Our coaches, TOSAs, and instructional specialists are aligned to and supporting based on those feeder patterns this year. This quote just is designed to align and really share the purpose of what we believe coaching is in the district. We really want to move it away from it being seen as something that is provided when you have done something wrong or in need of repair, and really shifting towards strength-based and maximizing their performance. It's a growth opportunity. So coaching is for every single person. And our coaches are doing a great job of starting to communicate that and connect with their colleagues in the building who are starting to engage in those learning opportunities with them. This next slide is just a reference to kind of the many jobs that coaches are tasked to do, but it really kind of boils down to these eight. So I'll give you just a few moments to kind of look around this infographic. And before we move on, one area I just want to focus on is number three. Our coaches are not evaluators. That's been shared at multiple levels and in multiple arenas, but they are non-evaluative. That feedback is between the coach and the teacher they are working with, and it is for that teacher. And so those conversations remain there in a safe space. We don't want coaches violating trust with a teacher who is striving to improve their practice. So that is one that I would like to highlight. But at any given time, all 38 of our building-based coaches or 33 of our building-based coaches and are engaging in this and being supported by folks up and down the system. So Jeff, we could just go back. Thanks. Our 3-year focus is to build teacher leadership skills. We begin that this year. One thing that we had identified as a group of directors is that we often will tag our best or our very strong instructional teachers for teacher leadership positions like instructional coaches, but then we have not provided them with the skills needed to work with adults. And so we wanted to provide some intentional support around that through our Teacher Leadership Academy. And so partnering with the CSTEP, the Center for Strengthening the Teacher Profession, they had a chance to build some relationships and skills and capacities in six different areas that effective teacher leaders tend to need when working with adults. And so we'll stay and stretch on that for the next 3 years. We want to continue to build their skills. And while we are still student-centered in our approach, we're really leaning into Elena Aguilar's model of coaching, which highlights compassion for our educators and the relationship and equity lens for our students and our teachers. And so this year, our coaches are immersing themselves in her book, The Art of Coaching. And so we will continue moving forward with that. And then step three, we're going to begin to build our skill and capacity around inclusionary practices through universal design. We want to move from deep knowledge into transferable knowledge, where both coaches and teachers are able to see how that is applied across content areas and settings, both within their classroom and throughout the building. And then also begin to center the learning experiences around culturally responsive education. And so some of our coaches are actually participating in some residencies that are taking place with Dr. Yemi Stembridge in some mathematics work and coursework in the secondary schools. And so we are not going to add to this, but we are going to go deeper each year and be supportive with folks who are real levers of change in the system. And so just I kind of covered this in the previous slide. We will be providing the coaches with some specific resources for their own bag as they attempt to support a variety of teachers throughout their buildings using a program called Goalbook, which is a really solid software program that offers lots of resources, resource support for coaches as they're engaging in coaching cycles. And then we're also using a service called Connect Hub to help support coaches in terms of, and to be able to see what are we coaching around as a system, what continue to be areas of strength, what continue to be areas of our growth opportunities, and just where our energy is throughout the system. And so coaches are spending really the first semester with this shift, just onboarding, and that's okay. We wanna go slow to go fast. And we're gonna take a look at strategic times in the year and measure our growth and progress with this new model. Are there any questions? Director Decker? I think you're on mute.
You're muted, Kathy.
All right. See, I was opening up my video and failed to open up my audio as well. Sorry. And Christy, when you were doing this, I thought you were telling me to be quiet. Which I've been told before. So I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
So in the past, when we've had instructional coaches at the at least the elementary level, they often had such ambiguous roles that I know that they were used to do tests, that all the iReady and SBAC testing and all of that, which basically pulled them off of the rotation for about 3 months of the school year. And then sometimes if there were behavioral issues, they were called in to help support that. And basically they became they did everything, right? A little bit of everything, but very little actual in the classroom coaching instruction. And I just want to make sure that not only are they aware of what their roles are, but all the administrators are also aware that these aren't people that are supposed to be called to do your test, set up and do your, fill in for the PBIS code or whoever. So would be my first question.
Yes, we have spent time as we were working on this realignment and in ongoing conversations with building administrators, we have made it abundantly clear that coaching is their primary role. We've also taken some safeguards to make sure that we can continue to support that. In terms of really the structure, the organizational structure, moving them to professional learning. Also in terms of the collaboration opportunities, I can speak specifically today, Director Decker, when principals and coaches were together for 3 hours this morning, going through specifically the roles of the instructional coach, the parameters for what coaching is and is not, and making sure that there was clarity in that before they departed. I think our coaches have felt supported in that thus far. And I will be visiting with them regularly just to do check-ins to make sure that they continue to feel supported throughout the year.
And I get how it all happens because particularly in elementary school, things are completely fluid. All of a sudden you have a runner that's going out the south door and you have a runner that's going out the west door and you need two sets of hands and those things happen. But if we start with the knowledge that that's not their task necessarily, then they won't be the second person, always the person that's called to assist when things go haywire. In that sense, I know I'm not making any sense. I'm sorry. Listen,
I've lived that, so I totally understand what you mean as a former building administrator. And right. I think what just typically happens is that our coaches are exceptional. They want to, which is why they're really loved in their buildings, and they say yes. But you can also start to wear down folks when you continue to go back to the well over and over. And so principals are being very intentional about how they use them and thoughtful about what they're asking. And that message is it's being heard, I think, throughout the system.
That's great. I love the fact that you have like defined roles and not just a label given to a certain teacher in the building. Like, this is our instructional coach, but we're going to use him or her however we want to fill in the gaps, but now we've got a specific role for them. And that's terrific. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We know it's a lot of information, and I really appreciate Kirsten and Christy to give us the overview. As you had it, if you get a chance to process more and questions come up, let us know. As Kirsten and Christy mentioned, not all directors are able to do site visits during the day, but we do have some opportunities coming up to kind of see it in action and see what hopefully the impact in schools at a preliminary level. But we think that we're getting some traction with that. And then there'll be an opportunity, right, to loop back to this goal as well. So as you're thinking about What stands out to you most that you would like to kind of continue to stay in touch with, knowing that the work's going to continue in all these areas, but it may be that as a board, you really want to concentrate on these three things and have Christy and Kirsten come back at some point to share. I know that some of you also had a chance to kind of participate in professional learning, whether it's through PLCs or conferences with our teams. So you're getting different layers of experience and exposure to this. So we think it's a pretty powerful opportunity for us to affect the experience and the learning for students. So if there aren't any other questions, Kirsten and Christy, thank you so much. We will transition to our next goal. And I'll invite Executive Director of Human Resources, Jeff Fish, and District Administrator, Victor Cato, who form a dynamic team in our HR work. And then, of course, that interacts with everything, right, in our system, as, you know, 85, 86% of our budget is staff. So Jeff and Victor, I will start sharing screen and drive for you. Just keep me posted on when you want me to move.
Thank you, Dr. Snow. So as you said, Jeff, this goal is also in student-centered staff, and I'd say it's very connected to what you just heard about from Christy and Kirsten. And I always think about something that Kirsten highlighted, building a culture of belonging, safety, and positive student-staff relationships. And I think that's how we in HR can really impact student achievement, and we try to keep that in mind, particularly in the recruitment and retention of staff and a diverse staff. So the goal itself is to invest in systems and resources to increase, retain, and promote a workforce that reflects our student population and whose practices align with our district's mission and goals. And then our strategic work plan, which is kind of a living document, is also linked there if you're interested in taking a look at where we are. But in this presentation, we'll highlight a number of the specific initiatives, projects that we have underway, and a little bit of the data that we've been looking at as well. And then we have that quote from a student, because we always want to remember how to connect our work in HR with students in the district. So our five-year vision is that we have recruited and retained a staff whose practices align, especially with our equity goals, including staff who are racially and multiculturally conscious. And that's how we're defining diverse staff, is staff who are really able to create a culture of belonging and understand where students are coming from and how to meet them where they are. And that's really what our WHY protocol says: to promote student access, achievement, and well-being, that we should strive to recruit and retain a staff whose practices align with our equity goals, including staff who are racially and multiculturally conscious, so that students see themselves in district staff who create a sense of belonging. So that's kind of our overarching why that we try to keep in mind as we are looking at the specific objectives and projects that we have going on. So our work plan goal, you'll hear about a lot of what we're doing, and we're going to outline our some of the steps that we're trying that we're doing now to try to make progress in 23-24 towards that five-year vision that I just read. And this is some work last year that was done by the HR staff. We had a series of meetings that Victor led to examine the hiring processes that we had in place at the time, and particularly to focus on the barriers that it might present to obtaining or recruiting and retaining a diverse workforce. So we did some revamping of the hiring process last year. We feel like that had some good results that we can report on as well. So as we go through this, there are three major areas that we want to talk about. One is recruitment and how we've changed the recruitment process. Another one is going to be retention and a number of projects that we have to retain employees or to figure out how to retain our quality workforce. And then also as part of that is going to be how we promote from within, or how we grow our own employees from the community, from schools, and through classified to certificated ranks. So at this point, Victor, if you want to start off with some additional information on our recruitment efforts.
Yeah, so thank you, Jeff, and good evening, board directors. We've had some exciting things happening over the past year in HR in this area around recruitment, particularly around our diversity goals. I'm excited to talk to you about it this evening and highlight some of that work. And so I'll hop right in this first slide with recruitment. One of the pieces that we've been doing is focusing on branding and how are we perceived in a community? And so in getting to that, we've expanded and targeted our community outreach. If we're going to be a community that is reflective of our, if we're an organization that is reflective of our community, that means we need to get community folks employed with us. And so that outreach is a critical piece for us. Over the past year, we participated in several community fairs. Although those are not like a traditional career fair, it allows us to interact with the community in a different way, to get to know the district as a resource, thus opening that door as a good employer. So that's the strategy behind that. The photograph that was shown here was taken at the Latino Community Resource Group at Fourth Plain Forward Spring Resource Fair that brought hundreds of families together to the Hudson Bay campus back in June. As you can see, one of our board members was there with us. We were very excited to see her. The team also participated in a Black student and family fair at Clark College in the spring as well. Also a parent night event that was sponsored by the district's Gear Up department. HR has partnered with other district departments and leaders such as the Chief Equity Officer, Janelle Ephraim, Gear Up and Brandy Elder, and Rachel Kaysen with the Office of the Education Ombudsman. The idea is we're at these events, people have questions. Here's a very non-threatening way to interact with the district and get the information that you need. So that's why we partner with other resources that are in the district. So it's kind of some sneaky recruitment that we're doing, but it's absolutely working. Also, moving on a little bit to our targeted recruitment, a key strategy for HR is partnering with culturally specific community-based organizations, so particularly those with active job boards, to post our career opportunities. These organizations have included Partners in Diversity, which is a regional collaborative devoted to retaining and developing professionals of color in our region, pretty well known. Similar to name and mission, the district has a long-standing relationship with Partners in Careers, which is a Vancouver-based nonprofit that's been tremendously helpful in staffing our classified positions, particularly transportation and paraprofessionals. They do amazing things on the recruiting front for us and being able to onboard people and get them through all of those barriers that usually prevent employment, like the cost of testing, the criminal background checks. Partners in Careers pays for all of that. So they go out and they recruit folks for us, and they also help them get through the application process. Additionally, the district launched a digital ad campaign this year that aired in both English and Spanish. The campaign focused on our bus drivers, and by all measures has been successful in that we've almost completely staffed our bus department, our bus drivers, and are now beginning to focus on building our substitute pool. And the last point is the selection process enhancements. And Jeff kind of spoke to a little bit of that in the slide before, where you saw the three photographs and lots of post-it notes. Although that was a fun activity, it did have some intention there. And what we were doing is trying to map all of the steps of our recruitment process. So we've begun conducting a self-analysis of current interview and selection practices to ensure that we're not losing diverse candidates in our recruitment and selection process. So we're keeping them in the pipeline. This has been a part of a more intensive review process in the spring, where we mapped out all of our processes from the time a PAF is submitted to request a new position, to the time that the job is posted, to applicant screening, then to interview, and ultimately the extension of a job offer. Jeff and I are taking that information and learnings to guide the team in identifying opportunities for improvement, particularly those in automation. We've also updated our interview questions, those that inquire about candidates' personal experiences with diversity, equity, and inclusion topics. We believe it's critical for us to communicate our expectation around the inclusive culture that the district has set out to build, both in our recruitment, our marketing, and our branding, but also in the onboarding of these new employees as well. The next slide, please. You're muted, Jeff. You're still muted.
Thank you, Victor. Okay, once we've recruited a diverse staff, then our next goal is to retain them. So in order to retain our quality staff, we have to listen to them. So here are a number of different activities that we're involved in, such as listening to staff when they exit our district, and then also listening to staff when they're in our district and finding out what it is that we need to do to keep people satisfied working for VPS. Also, the internal work within the HR department and looking at all of our labor relations as well to see how we are supporting our employees. When it comes to exit survey data, we have a regular exit survey that's been administered or that is offered rather to staff as they exit. Preliminarily, we think that that is not getting a great response rate. So we wonder about the validity of some of that. We'll be looking more closely at that this year and then also looking at the possibility of potentially redesigning the exit survey and then also starting to target specific individuals as they leave specific positions as well. In addition to that, we've contracted with a company called Upbeat. They are a group that works with many districts throughout the country. They're in over a dozen states, and their exclusive work is around performing retention surveys for school staff. So they only work with schools. They have research-based research-based questionnaire that is divided into groups of questions that get to the heart of why someone might leave the district or why they might stay. So questions like, how often do you engage with your supervisor or principal? Do you receive positive impact, positive feedback from them? And then they take that data and they you're able to look at it on a district-wide basis or a school-by-school basis. But then afterwards, they analyze the data with you and also propose research-based tools that you can implement to address the areas that you're weakest in, basically, in the retention survey results. And they also work really hard as a third party to be seen as an objective and to act as an objective third party that can collect data and also analyze that data. They have a very good success rate with the number of replies that they get. And so they have a very good completion rate for their survey. So we're looking forward to working with Upbeat. We plan our first survey for both certificated and classified staff in the beginning of November. We also plan a spring survey as well. So we're hoping that by December, we'd be able to have the data from that first fall survey that would allow us to look at different retention strategies that we would add into the work plan. In addition to Upbeat, we have a wellness program that has just started. We are actually going to be working with the staff advisory as our wellness committee. We have a policy that requires a secondary traumatic stress committee for staff. And so that staff advisory will be acting as that, as well as our overall wellness committee. And while we don't have specific people to lead that work, we're hoping that the staff advisory will be able to work with us and Alliance for a Healthier Generation in developing resources that we can bring out to schools and to individuals, to individual staff in the district as well. So there'll be the wellness work also starting up to support staff retention as well this year. In addition, our director of equity, Andre Harganani, has started affinity groups last year and will continue them this year to support specific groups of diverse employees by gathering together. And then Victor primarily has led the diversity, equity, and inclusion work within our monthly department meetings, so that last year we mirrored the DLT, the leadership team's work with developing a culture of belonging, and specifically ask about HR practices and whether they are supporting a culture of belonging and developing one for all staff and students in the district. So that DEI work is continuing within our HR department as well. And then lastly, we want to proactively plan for our upcoming negotiations and for all of our labor relations and how they impact our employees, and make sure that in doing that, we're supporting our employees from a district perspective as best as we can in all of those labor relations and negotiations. And those are the steps at this point, or some of the initiatives that we'd highlight in our retention work in HR.
Jeff, before we go to the next slide, one of the things I would add to that is with our retention strategy, the better we get at retaining employees, the better our recruitment strategy is. If we can retain the diverse talent that we have already within our ranks, these folks are our best recruiters. They go out into the community and they tell the story of how great it is to work here at Vancouver Public. And so that's why we're really putting a lot of energy in how we are retaining our employees.
I'll always remember, Victor, one of the first times I met you, you said retention is recruitment.
Yeah. Yep. Recruitment is the failure to retain. So if we're not able to, it's hard for a lot of educators to accept that word failure, but we have to flip our thinking around it. So next slide is grow your own. And this is what I'm really excited to talk about too, as a former CTE teacher, because I get to begin by talking about these teacher cadet programs, which is a great way to get a young person into a profession very early. Part of our strategy this year is to continue and possibly expand our careers in education CTE programming here in the district. This is very much a early recruitment strategy and a hallmark of successful Grow Your Own programs, which this year we were able to stand up our own here in the district called Vancouver Rising Educators in collaboration with our CTE department. The idea behind this is to support the district's first program cohort. So we're going to continue doing that this year. We have about 8 students that we've hired, former students that were in our CTE program. We've gotten them through their para pro and their background check, and we're going to place them in buildings this year as a building-based sub. And the idea is that they will get this experience also while they're attending Clark College as a cohort as well. And helping and recognizing that going through a Grow Your Own program has a cost, and that's often a barrier for folks to continue their education. We're very fortunate and excited about the Ron Porterfield Legacy Fund as well, and standing that up. Some of our labor associations have already donated, and we're continuing to gather funds for that with a release anticipated in this fall for the first round of scholarships. And then our last bullet is our LEAD program here in the district. So we want to continue that LEAD work for aspiring administrators. It's a partnership with WSU Vancouver. It's a great opportunity for existing educators to continue their career development, because ideally a Grow Your Own path has multiple entry points. It's not just for the high school student. It's for the current employee, the para or the janitor that wants to continue their education. It's for the teacher who wants to skill up and learn a new skill, or perhaps pick a different endorsement or go on the administrative track. So that's kind of the vision of what we're trying to build here in our Grow Your Own efforts.
So since we have all of this going on, I think the question that I had when I was looking at the work plan is, how do we show progress? How do we show progress in building a diverse staff that creates a culture of belonging for all students? So looking at the data, some of the characteristics of our students and staff, we looked at the data that's reported by OSPI on our district. And So when we look at that and look at what OSPI reports, they report on gender and they report on race and ethnicity. So you'll see our student population is roughly 50-50, male and female, and then is about 54% white. And so that means about 26% students of color. Also, OSPI reports some additional data, which is harder for us to get comparative data for staff. So we can look at gender and race for staff, but notable, we have English language learners at 15%, over 15%. We have students with disabilities, almost 17%, and we have low income students. Over half of our students are low income at about 56%. So this is all important data when it comes to how do you make students feel like they belong, but it isn't data that is very easy to compare to staff data. So when we look at staff data and what OSPI reports, they do report, as I said, on gender and on federal race and ethnicity. So when it comes to gender, we have about 74% of staff who are female and 26% male. And then when it comes to race and ethnicity, about 88% of our staff, this is a couple of years old, this data, but that's the most recent that OSPI reported, I believe, is white. And then we have about 12% of staff who are staff of color. OSPI also looked at that data over the course of time. And during this 5-year period ending 2 years ago, you can see that our staff racial diversity has remained pretty consistent with about 12% staff of color and 88% white staff. So just to be clear, we can look at race and gender as data points, but we may not use race and gender in any part of our consideration in hiring. So we make sure that that is the case and that we're not considering race and gender when we're hiring, but we will again look at data that's been reported by OSPI in the future to measure some changes. When we look at the data that we do have over the last couple of years, we can look at our hiring data for last year and then hiring data for the year before. So you'll see 21 and 22 data for hiring and then 22, 23. So 2 years ago, and then that's broken out by classified staff, certificated staff, and then administrative staff. So you and for the classified staff, it's our VAS staff, so office personnel and paraeducators primarily. And you'll see that in 2 years ago, we hired 97 total VAS new employees, with 86% of those employees being white and 14% staff of color. And then last year, that moved to 74%. White employees and 26% staff of color. So almost the doubling of staff of color hiring from 2 years ago to last year. And we hired more staff, more VAS staff, by the way, 214 total. If you look at our certificated new hires from the last couple of years, you'll see that our diversity, racial diversity has increased from 9% staff of color for a total of 16 people hired 2 years ago to 26% staff of color, or 48 people hired in last year in 22-23. And then when it comes to administrators, obviously a lot fewer in number, but you'll see that from 2 years ago, one person, 12% staff of color hired as new administrators. Last year, six people, or 54%, staff of color hired as new administrators. So that's the data that we can show for our recruitment results over the last 2 years. We hope to continue to track this data and also see what impact it has on the OSPI data that's reported for our staff as well. So again, our 23-24 measurable outcomes that we hope to track and be able to report back on is what Victor reported on already, our VRE, or Vancouver Rising Educators cohort, our Grow Your Own cohort. Hopefully we are helping to move them through their education at Clark College while at the same time acting as employees to help support them financially. Katie Morrison-Seward in CTE has done a great job of leading that work. We also hope to be able to report back on our lead cohort, and those are our current certificated staff who are aspiring administrators. We have a cohort of 11 certificated staff of color in that lead program right now. And so we hope to report on their success moving into either administrative intern or administrative positions. And then we want to continue to expand on the community recruitment events that Victor explained in some detail earlier on, and then implement strategies to improve retention after we've taken a look at that Upbeat data and recommendations from Upbeat about staff retention. And just generally speaking, we want to show continued progress in the data of recruitment and retention of diverse staff and hiring staff whose practices align with our equity goals and staff who are racially and multiculturally conscious. So those are the areas that we would want to highlight that we can report back on. Victor, do you have other comments about any of that?
No, I think we're all just really optimistic to see what our numbers are like and very much interested in this our VRE program and watching it grow over the next few years.
So that's what we have at this point. Thank you. If you have any questions, we'd be glad to try to answer them.
I don't have any questions, but this is really exciting. I loved when you were talking about recruitment, kind of thinking outside the box, because I think a lot of times you think about where do you go to recruit? You go to career fairs. And that's, I mean, when I first saw the picture and heard you talking about fairs, I mean, that's immediately what I thought, career fairs, and the fact that just thinking about, you know, we like to think about our schools as being part of the community. And so thinking outside of just going to a place where people are looking for jobs, but actually being a part of the community and going to those places, I think the people that might not be thinking about a job in education or thinking about, you know, kind of those positions. And it's like, we have these opportunities. I think I'm excited about that. And also the survey, I think is going to be interesting, and just what we hear back from staff. I think that's going to give us really good input on, you know, what staff are feeling, you know, positively about the district, but also areas where we can improve just in helping our staff feel a sense of belonging and a part of kind of our community. So I'm excited to kind of see where this goes. But thank you for all your hard work on this.
Go ahead, Kyle. No, Kyle, go.
I just want to echo it. I'm blown away just by some of the different approaches. Obviously, we can't expect different results if we're doing the same old thing. So thank you for laying this out for us. I'm particularly intrigued by the LEAD program of where we're kind of developing our own students and graduates, and think that's a way of bringing in student voice, of course, right? So we become very informed educators. I'm wondering specifically how going forward we'll market that program, or is there a template of who the good candidates are? So as our students are going through CTE, or maybe that's a work in progress still, of how we identify and grow that potential candidate for that program.
Yeah, for the Vancouver Rising Educators program, our kind of student to staff and certificated staff pipeline, part of the pipeline, that is very much a work in progress. And this is just sort of the initial stages of it. So I'm really excited to see where that goes and hear from the people who participate in it, what they need to be successful. And so I think there's going to be a lot of learning there, and we're starting out with a small group, and we hope that that grows over the next few years. As far as the LEAD program, our aspiring administrator program. Dr. Snell, I know you're very involved in that. Bill Ohman, Janelle Afram have both been very involved in that. I don't know if you want to speak to that as far as kind of the aspirations there, but I feel like that's work, that's the excellent work that has gone on before Victor and I got here, and we just hope to see that continue.
I think I used the wrong acronym, so I apologize, but thank you for answering. I think it's always daunting to have a new job, right? But if you are a student that's homegrown in the community and the culture, you know exactly what you're getting into. So I think that retention rate would also be high. So I'm excited to see how all of it develops and grows, but particularly how we are leveraging our student talent.
Yeah, I think there'll be a lot of challenges, and hopefully we'll learn from the folks who are going through that now how to better support people.
Thank you.
One of the things that I love about the work that you've done is that rather than look at how do we get more people of color, how do we get more culturally diverse, you're looking at why aren't we getting them? Why aren't we getting people to fill this? And so what do we need to do differently in order to outreach? And knowing that, I mean, the LEAD, for example, the LEAD program, which is a great program, it's well known that women and also people of color are less likely to put themselves forward for an admin program. And if you create a program that's specifically designed for them, or that brings them in, it's sort of like asking them, like, would you do this? And when women or people of color are asked, they were like, oh yeah, I'll do that, but very rarely step forward to it. So that is a tremendous program. I'm very excited. I know some of the people that are in that program, and we're going to have some really great admins in a few years. My only request on the data is when looking at our new hires of color for certificated, I want to make sure that we're also able to kind of break it out, like what percentage of those new certificated staff of color were hired for general ed versus were hired for our dual language program. Because we in some ways we're artificially inflating our overall numbers, like who's teaching at King and who's teaching at Ogden and who's teaching at those places that don't have, well, I think King does, don't have the dual language program. Do we have representation at schools that don't have the dual language program? Or are our numbers kind of artificially inflated because we're hiring so many native Spanish speakers? So if we can kind of parcel that out to see, it's great. I mean, the numbers are up, but I want to make sure that we're looking at where that representation is. Is it across the board or is it only in pockets? That would be my only add, but the rest of it is just, it's so exciting to watch all these programs come in. So thank you for all that work.
I will also echo what all board directors are saying. I think when I saw you guys at the resource fair, I was really excited because I don't think I've seen VPS at our cultural fairs or cultural events. So I think it really, even for me, it surprised me. And so I was just really taken back and really excited to see you guys there. And I'm also really excited to see the fund from Principal Porterfield. He was my principal when I was in elementary school. So I just know that that fund will do so much good for so many educators. He was an amazing educator in our district. And so I thought that was just really amazing. And just thank you both for all your hard work. And I think everyone has a part, everyone plays a part. And it's really exciting. I think, I've been on for 2 years and we've been talking about this. And so I think to see it flourish has been really, I think in this moment is very pivotal. It feels very pivotal. I don't know about, but it feels like we're heading in the right direction, and it's just really exciting.
Thank you. Something that I've said to the cabinet is that I feel like a lot of this work was already ongoing before Victor or I got here. So we're just hoping that we are able to gather the work and help move all of it forward.
As you can probably tell, that Victor and Jeff are very humble in their leadership, and Christy and Kirsten as well. I think it's important to note that these four administrators that presented to you today are 3 years or less in VPS in these roles. And so they're taking on new challenges and looking at it from a fresh perspective. And as Jeff said, building on some great work before, but coming out of the pandemic, I think the timing of all this is really important too. And your direction as a board is empowering this work. So there's two parts that I would like to end with before turning it back to you, Director Zavala Ortega. One is the content tonight is two of our 8 goals. And so if you have comments about the goals and content of that, I know that Jeff and Victor and Kirsten and Christy and myself would appreciate, right? Like, we want more of this, or we're curious about that, or this is really important to us. So that's one aspect. And then the second aspect, just a huge shout out to the four that presented, because they're the first, right, that started this like draft, you know, hopefully on October 10th, it's approved by you as a board, but we're anticipating that you want us to do some of the work in this area. So the model, you'll note that there was some similarities between their presentations, you know, just the, from action plans to progress monitoring to why protocol, things like that are things that we're trying to put into place so that you as directors with each presentation can anticipate, like, okay, I wonder what are the connections here? What are the progress monitoring steps? And those are all things that can be tweaked as we move into the strategic plan. And so, you know, hopefully over time, we can really dial that in so that you as directors can use your lens of like what's important for the community to see, knowing that we're going to progress monitor every aspect of the strategic plan, but some of that needs to be elevated up to a study session. Some of that maybe needs to be information on our website or whatever it is. We're really seeking feedback both on content and process. And so our next round of presentations will be focused on student experience and that and student learning. And that will be in October 24th, I think, is our next study session. And so the vision of a graduate is the focus on student learning, and the student experience is one of the goals, like you heard from student-centered staff today. So I'll just leave you with that. Appreciate your attention. I know these study sessions, especially on Zoom, like when you're sitting in one space for an hour and a half, right? We appreciate your focus and thoughtful questions from beginning to end. And with that, I will turn it back to you, Director Zavala Ortega.
Thank you. I don't know about all of you. I know it was long, but it felt really good and really in depth. And we really appreciate everyone's hard work and giving us a very informative and as well, I would say, uplifting, if that makes sense, like keeping us engaged, because I know how hard this can be. So it is 7:02. Our meeting is over. Have a great Tuesday night. Thank you.